Happy day! at last, meeting face to face. I am yours, Jesus, you are mine. Endless joy, perfect peace. Earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. What a glorious way that you have saved me. And oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious name. Hey, and oh, happy day. Happy day. You wash my sin away.
Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground.
rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Thank you, Lord.
Bob's going to come at this time. Please remain standing. Sinners all the time, but it's good to know that you know yourselves well enough. Oh yes, let me try to turn this on. Is that better? Check. Checking. All right. Good morning, sinners. Well, first of all, I want to say that Michelle and I are so thankful to be here. We traveled up this morning and brought our kids with us. Sleeping in the van. And we're so grateful to be here and to be on staff. And I got to let you know, since being here, you have a wonderful staff. They are multi-talented, like Mary Lynn, who literally puts endless hours into a lot of things that are done around here, as many of you know. And Merv, a guy that's very sensitive and compassionate, at least to me. If you haven't experienced that, hopefully you will. But a fellow that is committed to God's word, and he prays a lot. I want you to know that he's a praying man. And we often just run into each other, into our offices, and you know what? We need to pray for this. And we do that. We take time to do that. And Sherry is so committed to the children, so capable and competent. So I want you to know that a new staff telling you that you have a competent staff here, and you should trust in leadership here as well. And I truly believe that when I was here the first time, I took in Merv's sermon about us planting seeds and it flourishing. That God has taken the last 5 to 7 years here at MBBC, and there's been a seed that has been planted. It's been a time of sowing. It's been a time of restoring hurt and healing. And God is ready to burst that seed. Does that excite you? That God is ready to grow his seed. Anytime God is ready to grow a seed, oftentimes it's the people that are not ready for God to do the growing. So that's my preamble this morning. I just want to say that you have a great staff here, and it's been wonderful to get to know many of you and your stories. And this morning, I'm so delighted to be able to maybe influence you just in a small way through the preaching of God's word. as Bob was praying, that God's word would richly dwell in us this morning. And I tell you, I don't stand up here on my own strength, because if it was in my own strength, it would be a bad thing. Because the title, Michelle and I's book maybe would contain some chapters, and the chapter headings would be chapter headings that would, you know, entail failure or learning. It would describe our difficulties through infertility, or our struggles in fostering four boys, or our challenge in finding God's will for our life and direction. You see, I'm not a man that is necessarily worthy to be preaching God's word, but a man who has been willing to listen to God, and here I am preaching his word. So get that order right. I want you to know that I'm humble here this morning, and God's word before me. I have an agenda, though, this morning, I must say. And the agenda is setting a foundation. A foundation for discipleship. Here I've been here, and I've been able to use my gift of music and words, and even the Christmas Eve and other times when we've been together with Bright Corner and stuff, to bless in the ways of music. Another component of my term here is discipleship. So this morning and next week, I don't know what Merv is thinking, giving me 2 weeks in a row at the beginning of the year. But this week and next week, I want to set a foundation for where we want to go. And I've talked to Merv about this in like where we want to go in the area of discipleship. Next week, we're going to talk about the Great Commission. How many know the Great Commission? All right. Now, next week is going to be, there's a little twist on it. Not that it's a brand new revelation, but there's a new twist. So next week, make sure you come and bring those that haven't come this week. And we're really going to forge forward thinking about the Great Commission. And are we really following the Great Commission? What does God really want from us as a church, as believers in him? And this week, we want to focus on a foundation. Because nothing more is important than a foundation. Do you agree? But I'm going to start by asking you a question. Who likes the end of a sermon? Well, raise your hand if you like the end of a sermon. Depends on the preacher. Okay. Well, I guess I'll ask that question at the end of the sermon then. Well, if most of you, if you're honest, you always like, okay, now he's wrapping up. He said, okay, in conclusion, or here's my main point, or Merv case, this is the last word. If you're honest with you, you like the end of the sermon. So this morning, I'm going to start with the end of the sermon. And that is the end of the sermon that Jesus preached on the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7. You know that Jesus preached a lot of great truths for people that are living in his kingdom. In the Sermon on the Mount, we have practical living. And at the end of the sermon, he wraps it all up with this scripture that we're going to put on the screen. Matthew chapter 7, verse 24 to 27. Therefore, everyone who hears these words, so he's just preached, so all these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew, they beat against the house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. The rains came, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. You see, this text concludes one of the greatest sermons ever preached. It includes many of the laws that we are to live by even today. So if you can go home and read Matthew chapters 5 to 7, there's a whole lot of practical living there. So in this, I want to outline my message this morning. We're going to take a look at two men. What, you never seen me draw before? Well, why are you laughing already? Two men. These two men have similar comparisons. They also have dramatic contrasts. And there's one clear conclusion that we're going to get to today. So I'm going to start with some similar comparisons. These two men have the same. Everybody say that? Okay, I spelled it right. That's good. All these men have the same vision. These two men had the same vision. They both wanted to build a house. Their dreams were the same. Their longings were the same. Their desires were the same. What makes these two men similar is that their visions for the future are the same. They both had a vision to build a house. Now, many of you may have had this vision to build a house. Now, I took some time this last week to go over some of my last 10 years of life to figure out how many homes that I have renovated as a general contractor in London, Ontario, with a great team and my wife as one of the designers. We had renovated over 400 homes in London, Ontario. Now, I desperately want to build something new. Has anybody done a renovation here? When you go through a renovation, all you can say is, we are never doing a renovation again. Next time, we're going to build something new. Now, this house that Christ is talking about could perhaps symbolize a few things for us. It could symbolize this vision could symbolize a life. Now, we all want a life. We want our husbands to get one. We all want a life that's worth living, so then when we're at the end of our life, we look back and we say, I'm so thankful I had that life. Another thing that it could symbolize is a family. Because families live in homes. And I'm sure if you have a family, that your desire for your family is to be strong, to be committed, to have faith, to enjoy one another, to not fight and quarrel, but to love, to grow, and to encourage one another. We all have that desire. And if you remember, the third thing that it could symbolize, if you remember the song Household of Faith by Steve Green. Does anybody know that song? We'll build a household of faith that together we can make. That one? No? Well, in the 90s, it was sung in like every wedding that I was a part of. So for that very reason, but not only that reason, this home that Christ is talking about could symbolize our faith. That our faith should be built on a strong foundation. Now, you're probably building all three of these in your life. You're building a life. You want a life that you're proud of, that your children are proud of. You're probably building a family that's strong and stable and vibrant. And you want to have a faith that stands the test of time. All of us fit in this brief story that Christ is telling. Both men had the same vision. Are you with me? Everyone say vision. Vision. Both these men had the same teaching. You see, it says in the text, those that hear these words of mine, and it says this for the wise man and for the foolish man, they both heard the same teaching. And in fact, they had the best teacher. The written word was communicated by the living word, the Son of God. This is the best teacher. They both had the same teaching, and they both had the same vision. Now, we're not talking about one man who had a love and desire for God's word and the other one having a total rejection of it. We're talking about two different men who sat under the same teaching, Jesus Christ. The third thing that they both experienced is storm. They both experienced the same storm. If you look in the text, it's literally word for word the same storm described for both persons, the wise man and the foolish man. It says the winds blew, storms rose, and it beat against that house for both of them. Now, everybody here, I'm sure, is affected by the storm. Not one of you, I'm sure, can say that your life has been 100% pure joy and bliss, like those televangelists tell you that it should be. You know, they say that, you know, once you come to Christ, that everything will be fine. You know that God's waiting for you with the keys to your next BMW and that new house that you want to build? Just believe in me and I will provide these blessings, these huge things. No, this is not how it is. Life's not always sunshine. It's not always exciting. Beside my bed at home, my wife has put, Michelle has put up a little saying. And I'm sure many of you have heard it. It says, life isn't about waiting for the storm to pass. It's about learning to dance in the rain. Now, isn't that true in life? I mean, I don't think that's in Scripture, but it still can be true. You know, life always has storms. And it's not just about pushing through them and getting through. It's about learning what we need to learn during the storm. Learning to dance in the rain. Life has its moments of tears. Yet we all share the same vision. We all share the same teaching, if you've been around church long enough. And we all share in a similar storm. Now, it might be a different rain for each of us, but it's still the same storm. So these are some of the similarities between these two men. You can take a picture of that if you want. In fact, I was going to take a picture of all those that raised their hand and said that they were going to like the end of the sermon for Merv, but... So some contrast between these two men. Now, the first one is very obvious because Christ says it himself. One is wise, and the other one is... a fool, or otherwise a moron. In fact, you might laugh at that, but if you look at the Greek text, it actually is the word moros, where we get our word moron. Or the S word. I didn't say it. Literally, Christ is trying to paint a picture that one is wise and the other one is foolish. And if you don't believe me about that Greek word, Google it. And if you don't believe everything in Google, which you shouldn't, check out the Greek text. It says moros. Now, Michelle and I had a cat when we got our first home. And we named the cat, it was a black and orange cat, and it was a stray cat. The first cat ever. It was black and orange. But you have to know something about this cat. It was out of control. So we gave a first name to it. We called it Mo. And we gave a second name, a middle name, Ron. So like any other mother, that when their children get misbehaved, they call it by the full name, Moron. Needless to say, that cat didn't last long in our house. Neither did the couches that it tore apart. But one of these men is said to be wise. The other one is said to be a fool. However, the wise man wants to build a house. He has a vision. He had the same teaching, and he was suffering through storms. The fool, same thing. He had a vision, same teaching, and going through the same storm. Christ defines the difference between the wise man and the foolish man here. And this is so important. This is the key point. Christ defines the difference between wisdom and foolishness. Wisdom is those who have an ear, let them hear the words of Christ. Wisdom is those who hear my words and put them into practice are wise. Foolishness in Scripture, according to Jesus Christ, is not someone who lives their life flippantly or someone who, you know, doesn't regard themselves to any structure. Foolishness in Scripture is those who hear the words of God and do not put them into practice. Wow. I'm a fool. We are at times foolish. So let's not think that this wise man and this foolish man is the church and the world. Let's not think that this is church and the workplace, or church and the family, or even ministry and something else. The wise man and the foolish man are sitting here today. Each of us can be seen in this story that Christ is teaching today. Now you have to know the foolish scene has run through all of Scripture. It's in the Old Testament, especially the prophetic books. Everyone did what was right in their own eyes. This is foolishness. If you continue, it's all the way through Proverbs about the fool. I mean, if you read Proverbs, you'd read the word fool 322 times. Now, even in this day and age, when this was written, Matthew is recording Christ's words, and there were foolish people in his day. Can you believe? The Messiah has come. Jehovah Jireh has come. And there are still people who are not putting into practice his teachings. Now, even think, thousands of years later, we have the written word, we have the living word has lived on this earth, and still yet, there are people who are not putting into practice Christ's teachings. Another difference. Another obvious difference. By the way, does anybody know the song from Sunday school about building your house on the sand? How does it go? The wife. Yeah, oh, good. All right, so many of you know this story from a young age. And if a lot of you don't know that song, we'll sing it after. way after. So another difference here is an obvious difference. And we all know this story, right? The wise man built his house on the rock, where the moron, as it were, foolish man, built his house on the sand. Michelle and I have an investment property that we picked up in Leamington. And many of you have seen it on Facebook, the pictures of it. Let me tell you, it didn't look like that when we first got it. It's a cottage, and it's on Lake Erie, about a kilometer away from Point Pelee National Park, if you know where that is. And it's on the lake, this cottage. Like, literally, it's 6 feet from the water's edge. It's the closest building to the water's edge on that stretch of road. And we knew this, of course, when we bought it. What I didn't take into consideration is that everything around this cottage property was sand. So we had a problem. The first day I showed up to the property, I opened the crawl space door, and there is 2 feet of water in our crawl space. And below that, sand. And you have to know one thing about sand, which many of you know because you played in sandboxes yesterday. Like yesterday, I meant to say. That sand is easily moved. I mean, especially when you have a storm. The first week we had our property, there was a huge storm. Waves were crashing over the break wall. And when I came, I mean, it looked different. The whole scene looked different. There was sand everywhere, including my crawl space. So why on earth, with experience, would someone build their life, their family, and their vision on sand? Luke tells a story in Luke chapter 6. He talks about the wise man and foolish man as well. Except for when Luke tells a story, he says the wise man dug deep, are the little words, literal words, dug deep. Now, when you dig deep, especially in rock, how many have a cottage up north or in the Muskokas or have seen? Okay, let's dream, okay? Let's dream that we have a cottage up north in the Muskokas, all right? Now, when you build up there, I mean, you're talking about a lot of money going up front before you even start seeing something happen. I mean, to dig deep in rock costs money. It takes time. It requires intentionality and attention. Building on sand, you can do it rather quickly. Why build a foundation? Pour a slab, start building. Building on rock takes time. And the key is it costs a lot of time, money, energy, resources up front before you even see the fruits of your labor. However, in our culture, we love to see things quickly. You know those tourist traps when you go on vacation? What do they want? Do they want you to have a good time? Partly because they want you to come back, but mostly they want your... Now, when you're flipping a house, or when I'm flipping a house, what do I want? Do I want the next family to enjoy the house? Well, partly, but not really. I mean, yes, I want them to enjoy life and find Christ, of course. But what do I want? I want return on the investment. Now, our culture is all about this. What do I get when I sow into this? Is it going to look pretty? You see, the foolish man builds his house, and only as much as he needs to, in order as long as people are walking by and looking at it, for selfish reasons. It's like one of those tourist traps. As long as the money's there, I'm going to keep doing this. And this is our trap in our culture. We read, we pray, we read Scripture. When it comes to making disciples, it's a matter of practice. That makes sense? Now, this is a Baptist church, and I don't want to offend anybody here this morning, because I grew up in a Baptist church. And Baptist churches are known for their knowledge. On the other hand, we have perhaps Pentecostals or others that are known for their emotional connection. And I'm not saying emotional as weakness, because I think they have great strengths in this. Their connection to the Holy Spirit and the relationship of God. And that's just kind of a broad stroke. So don't say, I'm not kind of putting up one on either side, because every church is different and unique. But what I want to get at this morning is that discipleship is not just teaching. Discipleship is practice. Okay? So that's an underlying thing that we're going to move forward with in this new year, is that discipleship is practice. Now, what does that cost and require? Time, energy, resources. Teaching all requires you to come here on Sunday for an hour. There's a lot of ways to get teaching, and I'm not demoting teaching. We need that. We need proper theological teaching, especially in this next generation that's losing solid teaching. We need that. So we should be pouring our resources into youth groups and young adults, getting them solid teaching, building relationships with them so that they can become proper disciples of Christ. But for us who have been around for a long time, we know a lot. Discipleship is practice. There is one more contrast, if I can turn my page here. Something that's very different from both of these. One is that the wise man who built his house upon the rock, he rose. The foolish man who built his house upon the sand, he fell. Now we have to know that true discipleship, being practiced, those God will bless and reward. For those who just know knowledge, they eventually, through the storm, will fall. Now here's a key thing in this passage, is that if you were to drive by the wise man and the foolish man's house, you would not be able to tell the difference. They both had the same vision. They both had the same teaching. So the wise man and the foolish man looked the same. The only time you will notice a difference between the wise man and the foolish man is after the storm. It's the only time. And let me tell you, you cannot build a foundation during the storm. Trust me, I've tried. I worked for a contractor in London, Ontario. My first time working for someone, and we were building curbs, concrete curbs, in minus 32 degree weather. I have no idea why we were doing it. In fact, it was so windy and cold, the fellow that was working with me put a bag over his head, plastic bag, poked two holes in it, just to keep the wind off his face. You cannot pour concrete in a storm. You can pour it before the storm. You can even learn and pour it after the storm. But it's very difficult to build a foundation during the storm. So whatever you do, put into practice God's teaching to build your foundation so that you will weather the storm when it comes. The same storm came on both of these people. It says the rains descended, the floods came, the winds blew, and the burst against that house. Now, whenever you have rains, floods, houses being knocked down, now that's a serious storm. So we're talking, this is hurricane season for both these men. And I know many of you have had hurricane seasons in your life. I've heard many of your stories recently of how trouble and trials and suffering has come into your life. So here's the clear conclusion, if you're writing notes or you're imprinting it onto your brain. There's been something very dangerous sneaking into our church culture lately. You know what makes it dangerous? Is that it looks like the real thing. The thing that is sneaking into our church culture is religion. That we are forming our lives based on routine, the desire to please, and forgetting that true discipleship is about hearing and doing. Doesn't Christ himself say to be doers of the word? He does. Christ did not come to start a religion, folks. He came to start a revolution. And a revolution changes lives. So the question is your life changing? Are your values and intentional times of prayer and reading scripture, is it changing? Is it moving? Is it rising? He who has an ear, let him hear what the Lord says. He who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice will weather the storm. I lost my business 2 years ago, and I lost my home about a year and a half ago, my mother about a year ago. Yet I still have my life. Only because I've allowed God to revolutionize my life. The reason I have it still. You see, God has chosen to take me out of the pit and set my feet on the rock. Christ said, on this rock, I will build my disciple church. I'm so thankful my mother was wise as she built her life on the rock, Jesus Christ. So I don't know what storms or hurricanes or tornadoes you will face. I don't know if you're going into a storm or coming out of one. I do know that foundations are merely not knowledge. Foundations are being doers of the word. Not good enough just to have a Bible underneath your arm or on your coffee table. But let's revolutionize the city of Burlington by being doers of the word. You'll be blessed for it. You'll be blessed for it. Let's pray. Father, I'm so thankful that in this story about a wise man and a foolish man, you did not complicate things. You didn't make it that we needed to have a whole lot of cognitive movement in our brains to figure these things out. Thank you that Christ spoke clearly. And then in the example of the wise man and the foolish man, we have one that heard and another that heard and did. God, motivate us. Help us to motivate one another to be active doers of your word. To read a simple message and then to go and take weeks and months and years of applying that message. God, forgive us for taking messages and stuffing them into our library, stacking them on the shelves, shelf upon shelf upon shelf, and forgetting that when the storm comes, that we have a wealth of knowledge. And even more so, that we don't put it into practice. God, thank you for your word that it says it will not return void for those that are living it and putting it into practice. And this morning, God, we have an opportunity to reflect on your Son through communion. And so we do that now as we reflect on your message to be doers of your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
The Lord never promised that there wouldn't be storms in our lives. But when there are, we know that we can stand on Christ, our cornerstone. Thank you.
trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand to you alone. God, my rock, God, my rock. You will stand when others fall. You are faithful through it all. God, my rock, God, my rock, God, my rock. In the blessing, in the fear, through it all you joy of my life. You are my song in the night. There is no one as true. Jesus, I trust in you.
For all of us listening to today's message, those that are here at NBBC and those that are viewing on Kojiko, we know the importance of having a strong foundation, the importance of reading and understanding Scripture. However, it's so easy to always be going to work, sports events, kids programs, hospital appointments, and even church. We need sometimes to stop our going and focus on our foundations. Christianity can often be summarized in one word, and the word is come. Jesus Christ himself said, "Come, you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest." He invited the children to come to me. I invite you now to come and to slow down your going and spend some time on building your foundation. Be like the wise man who built his house on the rock. God bless you and have a great week.